I guess if you haven't already turned in your homework on your way in, then you can do that on your way out. The graded exams are also up front. The next exam is a week from today. We'll get through most of the material for that today. There's going to be a little bit left over on Monday probably that will be on that exam. And then also on Monday we'll probably have time to start up the following unit. Monday night at 8 p.m. there's going to be a review session over in Wien 4623. I will have some prepared material and some time for you to ask questions in that time slot. So I've got the room reserved for over 2 hours. I estimate that it'll probably be about 35, 40 minutes of prepared material, probably about as long as people have questions for, but I'm happy to be there as late as anybody else can stand to listen to me. So last couple of class periods, we've talked about this idea of how brains encode information, and then also how they decode that information. So I guess, or more properly, how sensors, the sensory neurons that are collecting information from the outside world, like the photoreceptors, the cones and rods in your eye, the touch receptors and tastes and olfactory receptors and so on, the auditory receptors in your ear, how all of those convert vibrations or physical stretch or photons or whatever happens to be out in the world into action potentials. So that top process is called encoding. And then how the rest of your brain takes that and converts it into a guess about what's out in the world, and we call that decoding. So two ideas for how this is accomplished are listed up here. So the first is a labeled line code, and that's just saying which cells are firing and which cells aren't. It's the sort of simplest possible question you could ask. You're essentially asking a yes-no question of every sensory neuron. Are you active or are you silent right now? And universally, neurophysiologists will tell you that that's definitely important for figuring out what's out there in the world. There are sensors in your body that are usually only active under certain conditions, maybe a vibration on your finger, maybe pressure on your finger, maybe a burning pain on your finger. And so most of the time, if those are active, then that stimulus is present. Most of the time when they're not active, that stimulus is not present. We can take that a step further and do what's called a rate code. And with a rate code, we ask a slightly more nuanced question, which is not just who's active and who's not, but how fast are they firing? So our neurons are noisy little biological machines, and they sometimes fire action potentials when they're not supposed to, when the thing that's normally sort of driving them isn't out there. And so maybe we pay more attention to the ones that are firing faster and less attention to the ones that are firing slower. Notice that if I tell you the firing rate of every neuron, you can easily tell me which ones are active and which ones aren't. You can tell me this, right? Any cell that's firing rate is zero is a cell that's not active. Any cell that's firing rate is not zero is a cell that is active. So we for sure have more potentially useful information to work with if I tell you the firing rate. Because you can easily, right, if I tell you who's firing, you don't know what rate they are. But if I tell you what rate they're firing, you can tell me who's firing. Does that make sense to everybody? So it's possible, although most neurophysiologists will tell you that this is not true, but it's possible that all the brain cares about is who's firing and who's not. Really, it's widely accepted, as I've written over there, that sensors do fire more. The encoding side, sensors do fire more when the stimulus is more, when the stimulus is sort of more, when their receptive field is sort of more present. So if a cell fires for a vertical line, if you have a faint vertical line, it might fire, might not, might fire kind of slowly. If you have a really bright vertical line, then it's for sure going to fire and probably a heck of a lot faster than it did for that faint vertical line. And so it's widely agreed and widely accepted that the rate does matter, and it both in terms of converting the world into action potentials, and also when the rest of your brain is trying to figure out what the heck is out there, it's in fact definitely does pay attention to the rate. And so we're just going to take that as sort of our starting place for today, that label lines is a good first pass at figuring out what's out there, which cells are active, which cells aren't. And there might be some questions. There are three practice exams up there. I've put the several practice exams. There's some overlap between them. But there are some questions that are just label line questions. You know, which cell's firing, which cell's not, what does that tell you? There are some that are rate-based questions. How fast are these cells firing, what does that tell you? But a first pass at figuring out what's out there is just knowing which cells are active. A better way to figure out what's out there is to figure out the rate that cells are active, how fast they're firing. And before I talk about the third option, which I've already mentioned before, which is a timing code, I just kind of want to illustrate an example of how we might use rate to figure out what's out there. So let's say I'm showing you fruit. We're playing another neuroscience party game, another sort of simple, stupidly easy neuroscience party game. I'm either going to put an apple in front of you or an orange in front of you, and your job is to tell me whether you're seeing an apple or seeing an orange. Or maybe we make it a little bit harder. Maybe so to make this a real fun neuroscience party game is I put an apple or an orange in front of me, and you don't get to see it. And I've implanted an electrode into my visual cortex, and it's recording from one cell. So you don't get to see the fruit. Let's do it this way. You don't get to see the fruit, but what you do get to see is what the cell in my visual cortex is doing, or my temporal lobe, or whatever. First, to give you some information to work with, to give you a starting place to work with, I put an orange in front of myself, and then you get to see the spikes. And now you know it's an orange. So you get to see the spikes, and there's three spikes that this cell fires. And then I do it again. I put an orange in front of myself, and maybe there's a little bit different timing, but there's three spikes again. I put an orange in front of myself. Maybe this time the cell just fires two spikes. Then I switch and I put an apple in front of my face, and this neuron fires four times. Put an apple in front of my face again, this neuron fires four times. Maybe I put an apple in front of my face again, this neuron fires five. So same neuron in both cases in my brain. The three times I put an orange in front of my face, those were the patterns of action potentials over time that you saw. The three times that I put an apple in front of my face, those are the patterns of action potentials. Any questions about the setup so far? Okay, so now I put a mystery fruit in front of my face, and all you get to see is the pattern of action potentials, and so the neuron does this. So what am I looking at? An apple. Awesome. You have done stimulus reconstruction with a rate code. You have figured out what the stimulus is out there based on the firing rate or number of spikes. Firing rate is sort of, if you have a fixed window of time, so we're going to say it's maybe 100 milliseconds, firing rate is the same thing as the number of spikes. Assuming that we have... assuming a fixed window of time, fixed time window. So then another time I put a mystery fruit in front of myself, and that happens. So what am I looking at? It's either an apple or an orange. What am I looking at now? Orange. Awesome. Yeah, great. You can amaze your friends at the party with that. So you can read my mind based on what this one neuron's doing. You can figure out what I'm looking at. Any questions about that? Okay, so now we're going to make the party game a little bit harder. And the way we're going to make the party game a little bit harder is same sort of setup, but now I'm not going to be either looking at an apple or an orange. Now I'm going to be either looking at an apple or a pear. And it so happens that this one neuron in my visual temporal lobe, whatever, that you're looking at, that you're observing the action potentials from, so you get a few test examples to sort of get a sense of what I'm seeing. So when you put that pear in front of me, So here, here are the patterns of action potentials. So we do a mystery fruit. And the mystery fruit, the first time, gives you something like that. So anyone have any guesses about what fruit I'm looking at in the mystery case? I heard pear. Why do you think it's a pear?
Because the pear has a consistent starting firing pattern that sort of gives it away, whereas the apple seems to have pretty much random firing pattern.
Yeah, I would say the apple's not quite random. The apple, I would say, is actually pretty evenly distributed over the time window, whereas the pear has sort of a burst early, a pair of spikes that come early on, and then it sort of starts to even out. If we're doing this, right, if you're just looking at the average rate of firing over this 100 millisecond time, you would have no hope of doing that, right? So if all I told you is four spikes, the apple gives four or five spikes, usually four, sometimes five. The pear gives four or five spikes, usually four, sometimes five. So if I just told you it's four spikes, you'd have no clue, right? So, another time I show a mystery fruit and I tell you four spikes, right? Now you have no clue which one this is. But if I show you a mystery fruit, if I show myself a mystery fruit, and this is what my neuron does, now what do you think that is? Somebody over here says apple. Yeah, right, because they're evenly spaced out. Okay, so what we call that is a spike timing code. And so in a spike timing code, what we want to know is the time. The time of every spike. Let's divide our 100 millisecond into five windows of 20 milliseconds each. So you can sort of be arbitrarily precise with this depending on how good your instrument is. We'll just say that we're sort of going to say maybe within a 20 plus or minus 20 milliseconds sort of thing. We're going to need to divide it up a little bit more finely than that. Every 10 milliseconds, something like that. So we sort of have 10 windows here that we're looking at. And so what we can do to actually make this a little bit more sort of formal and also more easily computable is we can convert this into essentially a binary string. So after I show the apple, there's no spike, then a spike, no spike, then a spike, no spike, spike, no, no, yes, no, something like that. So I've converted that. This analog signal of spike times, the sort of delta functions of spike times, into now what we call a word, a binary word about what this spike train is. And so I can do the same thing for this, and it's going to come out, maybe about the same, something like that. This one has an extra spike in there, so it's maybe something like that. Notice that if I tell you the time of every spike and I tell you the duration of the window, then you can tell me the rate, right? So this necessarily has the rate embedded in it, right? So in other words, if I tell you the time of every single spike, I say, there's a spike that happened 20 milliseconds in, another one that happened 40 milliseconds in, another one that happened 55 milliseconds in, another one that happened 85 milliseconds in, you can say, okay, well, that was 1, 2, 3, 4, so the rate is 4 spikes over that 100 milliseconds. So just like if I tell you the rate, you can tell me who's firing and who's not. If I tell you the time of every single spike, you can tell me how many spikes there are, right? Does that make sense? So for the pair, this would be like 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0 or something, and 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, something like that, 0, 1, 0. And so then for these mysteries, we get 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0. So the thing that you're looking for as a decoder trying to figure out what the eyeballs attached to the brain are seeing is this pair of spikes, this sort of doublet of spikes close together early on. And that's something that is not available if I just tell you the rate, but is available if I tell you the time of every spike. And I could either do that by sort of showing you the spikes in continuous time or with some sort of digitized string of spikes. Okay, what questions do people have about that? Yeah, sure.
So what's the step order in which you like assign the spot? So it seems like you put like two zeros.
So if I were more careful, then I would divide my time window into evenly spaced bins, and then if there's a spike in that time bin, then I'll put a one. If there's no spike in that time bin, then I'll put a zero. Since I'm doing this on the board, I'm being kind of sloppy about it. There's actually in the course notes for the unit four, it goes through an example very similar to this with apples and pears that is a little bit more organized in the way that the spikes are digitized. But yeah, what you would do is you just sort of take, if it's a 100 millisecond time window, maybe you divide it into 10 segments, and then in each 10 millisecond long segment, you say, is there a spike there or not? Is there a spike in this one or not? Is there a spike in this one or not? And so on. Yeah. Yeah.
Is it possible that you can have two spikes?
Yeah, in which case sometimes you put a two, sometimes you just say, oops, I didn't divide it finely enough, and then maybe you cut it into 5 millisecond. You try and cut it down so that you're narrow enough. And so the words get longer. If I divide a 100 millisecond time window into 1 millisecond bins, then my words are going to be 100 digits long, 100 bits long. If I divide into 10 bins, then my words are going to be 10 bits long. If you're sort of being really formal about this, you get better timing precision if you divide up into smaller bins, and you're less likely to have two spikes in the bin if you do that. Yeah. Yeah, you had a question too. Yeah.
This makes it seem as though this is all just one cell firing differently for different stimuli. How does that sort of change as we like move into places with larger and larger receptive fields as we get more and more specific for different things? Or is it really just one cell that has all fruit and then just fires?
Yeah.
Fruit, or is it a bunch of different cells that identify different fruits?
That's kind of the question here, in a sense. So. Before I fully answer that, let me just sort of say over here that it's somewhat debated whether information is encoded this way, and even more debated whether information is decoded this way. And so, for example, I might have stumbled upon a cell that fires really reliably in one pattern for an apple and a different pattern for a pear. But maybe as far as the rest of my brain, the decoders, the classifying part of my brain is concerned, that cell is useless to me. Maybe it says force. Maybe all the rest of my brain pays attention to is how many spikes this cell has given me, the rate of firing. And so for the rest of my brain, even though us as experimenters, we can look at it and we can say, wow, that cell's great. It fires a burst, and then it fires uniformly for an apple. Maybe the brain's like, I can't tell the difference between that. It's four spikes. And so the rest of the brain says that cell's useless. And the way I tell an apple from a pear is because there are other cells elsewhere in my cortex that fire maybe 8 spikes for a pear and maybe 1 spike for an apple. And if it's reliable at that, then that's what my brain's maybe going to be paying attention to. And so we're going to kind of skip past some work. There's been dozens and dozens of research papers that show, actually I would say it's only slightly debated, this first point. This first point here is only sort of slightly debated, because there's dozens and dozens of research papers that show that in fact, for different stimuli, you can find individual neurons that have different firing timings, different firing patterns, and the timing is informative to you as an experimenter watching those action potentials with a little wire that you've got next to that cell. But the real sort of unanswered question is, do nervous systems, can a natural nervous system detect that difference and perceive something different based on these differences in timing? And so that's kind of where we're going for the second half of class today. Yeah. Before I go on to that, though, what other questions do people have about that? Okay, so in a sense, we've already done stimulus reconstruction. All that means is I tell you the spikes, and then you tell me what the external stimulus is. Stimulus reconstruction is exactly the same thing that the rest of the brain is doing. And we talked last class period about how context and expected stimuli can play a role in stimulus reconstruction. And the example of your home by yourself, with three of your roommates and one of the roommates is out, and then you turn around and some neuron starts getting active. Probably, if that neuron normally responds to Emily, but Emily's out, probably that neuron's just misfiring and it's really Carol you're looking at, or whatever it was from the example from yesterday, from Monday. Because Emily's out, and so you have good reason to think that she's not there. Every once in a while, Emily will have snuck back home without you looking, and you might mistakenly identify her as Carol because she's out of context for you right there. And so, in fact, usually your brain is a good idea that it takes into account context, because it means it's going to make fewer errors. But it's kind of surprising when we can find evidence that our brains are Bayesian in the way they classify things by the fact that seeing stimuli out of context makes it harder to identify them than when they're in an expected situation. So that sort of stimulus reconstruction is taking some feature, whether it's the timing of action potentials or the number of action potentials, or just who's firing and which neurons are firing and which neurons aren't, So this example with Emily and Carol and everybody yesterday was sort of a labeled line code. Here we went through rate code and spike timing code for sort of stimulus reconstruction. So for today and a little bit into next Monday, we want to talk about this sort of slightly debated point first, which is the encoding capacity, which is to say, is there useful information available that a nervous system might take advantage of in the timing of spikes? So do our nervous systems operate like this, at least in terms of encoding, right? So with this setup here, all I've done, if we actually did this experiment and stuck wires in my brain and everything, all this would prove is that there is information encoded in spike times that you as an external observer could take advantage of. This doesn't prove that this is actually what my brain is doing when it's figuring out whether I'm seeing an apple or a pear. Maybe, like I said, my brain doesn't care about the timing of the spikes, and it's just like 4 spikes is 4 spikes, and so that neuron's not going to help me with that problem. So that's sort of, but anyway, the first question is, first of all, if we're ever going to get to the point that we say that our neurons are using spike time to decode, we first have to convince ourselves that at least spike timing is present in the encoding side. So that's sort of the first job for today. And then the second job, which will start today and continue on Monday, and the, sort of the last topic for the exam coming up on Wednesday, is what do brains actually use? How do they decode these spikes? And does spike timing, maybe spike timing is present in the encoding, but the brain ignores it. Or maybe spike timing is present in the encoding and the brain makes great use of it. And so that's sort of the way we're going to go. Any questions about that? Okay, so there's an article posted on Blackboard and some slides. We're going to skip these. It's one of these examples that's early research showing that, in fact, on the encoding side, spike timing works. But I want to skip to sort of the main research paper that does a good job of looking at really both sides of that question. First of all, is spike timing present, is information present in the way neurons encode stimuli in their timing of action potentials? So this is sort of our encoding question, and then also the decoding question. And this paper does it in a simple organism, the medicinal leech, the same thing that doctors in the 1800s used to use and whenever you got sick with anything, and sort of just get the leech to suck the illness out of your blood. And so this is an animal that turns out to have a very simple nervous system that makes it very easy to manipulate and record and change the timing of spikes in its sensors. So as far as we're concerned, a leech is just a tube. And unlike us, where our nervous system runs along our back, in a leech, the nervous system runs along the belly side, the ventral side. And so what we can do is we can take the leech is essentially a cylinder. And so you can take a cylinder and cut it along the back and then flatten it out so that now you have a sheet of skin. And so this poor leech has been converted from a cylindrical animal into a sheet of skin. And it has its nervous system still attached. And one other nice feature about the leech is that it doesn't have much of a brain, which also makes you feel less bad about doing this to the poor animal. But in fact, most of its nervous system is sort of processed, is sort of present in segments throughout the body, which we call ganglia. So most of its processing happens in sort of like in a zone by zone, and there's something like 36 ganglia throughout the leech. And so each little zone of the leech is its own sort of isolated organism practically from a nervous system perspective, where it's got its own little tiny brain with like 300 cells in it, actually no, 130 something cells in it, that controls that segment of the animal. Okay, so we've cut our leech along the dorsal, the back side, and so now what used to be the ventral side is in the middle of our sheet. What used to be the left and right sides are now sort of halfway to the edge of our sheet. And then what used to be the dorsal side is now the edge of our sheet of skin. That makes sense? Any questions about the setup here that we've got? Okay, and so this leech has a really simple nervous system, which makes things very easy for us. It essentially has four touch receptors. The touch receptors are, so our leech has four touch receptors. And there's a touch receptor called P for pressure, DL. So that means pressure along the dorsal or back left side of the body. VL, so pressure along the ventral or belly left side, PVR, and PDR, so belly right side and back right side. And in fact, we're going to make the problem even simpler than that, because we're only going to touch it somewhere in this zone along the middle part of our sheet, which corresponds to what used to be the belly part back when this sheet of skin was a tube of leech. So we're really only activating two neurons. There's only two sensory neurons that we have to worry about. PVL, which is our left sensor, and PVR, which is our right sensor. And their receptive fields somewhat overlap. So if I touch the leech dead center in the middle of its belly region, then they're both going to become equally active. If I touch the leech a little to the left of its belly region, then PVL is going to be more active than PVR. If I touch it way over to the left, then only PVL will be active, and actually PDL will start to get active a little bit too. But we're just going to sort of stay in this region of overlap, where so dead center, they're going to be equally active. A little to the left of center, they're going to be the PVL is going to be more active. A little to the right of center, the PVR is going to be active. Okay. It's got to be some questions by now. It's like a crapload of acronyms and terminology and everything. So yeah, so what questions do people have about that? Okay, so one other nice feature of this animal is that they have a reflex where if I poke it, it bends away. Poke it, bends away. And so we can, and also as is illustrated here, you can expose its nervous system while you are touching the skin that is still getting input from that nervous, that is still giving input to that nervous system and still getting output from it. So I can expose the nervous system, touch the animal, see the action potentials in these cells. It's only got two sensory cells, so I can be recording all of the sensory information this animal has is in these two cells. So I can touch the animal, see all of its sensory information that's getting in, and then watch where it moves. And if I watch where it moves, the spot where it moves tells me where it perceived the touch to come from. So back to our diagram over here, we can provide a stimulus, record the responses in all two of the sensory neurons that matter, and then figure out the perception based on where the animal moves. So we've got sort of nearly a complete picture of this whole process. Any questions about that? Okay, so in doing this, then, in this study, they looked at three different aspects. We're really only going to pay attention to two of the three aspects of this, which is, so actually there's two different experiments that they did. So back to our pre-drawn diagram here of this sort of six-step process. We've got two sensory neurons that we worry about, PVL and PVR. So what I can do is I can record the whole set of action potentials that this animal has coming in. So what's shown here in panel A is if I touch 12 degrees to the left. And so what the heck is a degree? Well, so the animal used to be a cylinder. And so a cylinder has a circumference, and its circumference is 360 degrees. So from here to all the way over here is 360 degrees of body wall. It turns out that a leech's circumference is something like maybe 3 inches or so. So 1 degree is about a tenth of an inch, a little less than a tenth of an inch. So So if I touch it 12 tenths of an inch to the left of the midline, then PVL fires in this pattern, and right below it we see what PVR did. And so PVL fires sooner. We call that the latency. So right, the time from when I touched, which is at zero, until the first spike, which is something like 30 milliseconds, 35 milliseconds. We can say how many total spikes did it fire over this 200 millisecond window. So there are 5 versus 3. And we could also look at other aspects of the timing, like this timing between spike number 1 and spike number 2, for example. So anyway, when I touch it on the left, the cell on the left fires first and fires more. When I touch it dead center, in this example, the cell on the left ended up firing more, but at about the same starting time. In other examples, the cell on the right fires a little bit more. On average, they fire about the same amount when I touch it dead center. And then when I touch the animal about a tenth of an inch. So I guess, yeah, 1 degree is 1 degree is a hundredth of an inch. Anyway, yeah, 1 degree is a hundredth of an inch. So about a tenth, 12 hundredths of an inch off to the right, then the right cell fires first and the right cell fires more. So why is this useful? Well, in a sense, it's sort of not, right? It sort of seems like it's not because because rate and timing are sort of tied in together. So touch left, then PVL fires first and fires more. And PVR fires later and less. So, you know, this question is sort of like, how are we going to make sense of this? And so here's what they did with that, is in this case, what they're interested in is encoding, like it says up here on the title. Actually, sorry, before I start talking about what they did, let me pause again. What questions do people have about that? Okay, so what they're interested in is encoding, which means they're going to let the animal do the encoding. So they're doing all of this, they let the animal do. And then right now, they're not going to pay attention to what the animal's behavior is, but instead, they're going to take these spikes and feed it into a computer program. And there are sort of three possible computers that we could imagine, three possible programs. So we'll call these artificial classifiers. So the brain is a natural classifier, but we're letting the animal do the encoding, and then we're using a computer to artificially decode or artificially classify it. So artificial classifier number one, you tell the computer just the rate of action potentials and nothing about the timing. Just how many spikes were there in that 200 milliseconds? Artificial classifier number two, you could tell it the time of every spike. But if I do that, that's sort of an unfair fight. Because if I tell a computer the time of every spike, and let the computer go through whatever sort of iterative algorithm it wants to figure out the best way it can classify things, then it's going to do better, or at least as well, as the one that I give rate to. Because if I tell it at the time of every spike, the computer knows how many spikes there are. So they actually ended up not doing this one, because they figured that that was an unfair fight, right? So here we're giving the computer one number, the number of spikes. Here we're giving the computer five numbers, or six numbers, or three numbers, the timing of every spike. And so that's sort of an unfair competition. Instead, what they did is they came up with a third artificial classifier. And this artificial classifier number three, they told it just the time of the first spike, which they called the latency. So this one, the time of every spike, they call the count. If you have a set window of time, then rate is equal to count divided by that set window of time. So here, what we're doing is making it a little bit more fair fight. We're giving artificial classifier number one a single number, how many spikes there were. Artificial classifier three gets a single number, which is the time of the first spike. Okay. So before we even feed this into an artificial classifier, what we can do is we can look at different touch locations. What's the spread of latencies that we get? So when we touch 12 degrees off to the left, how tight are the latencies? When we touch 6 degrees off to the left, how tight are the latencies? When we touch 6 or 12 degrees off to the right or dead center, how tight are the latencies? And we can say also, so for the spike count, there's a correlation. So here this is an inverse correlation because the short latency, the low latency, means that it's over to the left. Whereas here, it's a direct correlation because over to the left means more spikes. But we can also look at spike count, and we see that there is a correlation between spike count as well as between latency and the response. But if you were a computer algorithm, let's pause for like 2 minutes. You don't even have to write anything down on this. But if you were a computer algorithm, would you rather have the latency or the spike count? So kind of discuss that with your neighbors, and then we'll come back and talk about it as a group. Okay, it sounds like a lot of groups have stopped talking about latency stuff, and I hear some conversation about other things. If you don't raise your hand, then I'm going to call on you. So you have to pick one or the other, or you can say that you don't care, and they're both equally good. So who thinks that latency is the better thing that you could use to more precisely figure out where you were being touched if you're a leech? Okay, who thinks that spike count is going to be the better thing that you're going to use? Okay, and then who thinks that it's both equally good? Everybody who didn't raise their hand for the others who should be raising their hand for that. Okay, does somebody who thought it was spike count want to say a little bit about why you think that one's better? I see you all are talking about somebody, so maybe I'll pick on JP. What do you?
I think like you're saying that, like at least with the spike count, we like can maybe figure out like latency from the spike count. Like if we're just given the latency, like we may not necessarily know how many spikes.
Yeah, that's true. The latency and spike count are correlated with each other, but it turns out that they're sort of poorly correlated with each other. So you're actually, you're not going to be able to very reliably figure out latency given spike count or figure out spike count given latency because they're both poorly correlated with each other. So that kind of maybe, did any other groups think spike count want to? What about anybody who thought it was latency? Want to say that, make an argument for why latency is the better thing to tell our computer if we want our computer to get the answer right? Sure, yeah. Right. So so with latency, you don't get necessarily a pattern information. Yeah, so anybody else have any thoughts about what else you could use? I sort of just, everybody's now afraid to talk because I said no to the first two groups. So actually, it turns out that if you do this, the computer does do better with latency. And the reason why is because there's a much tighter correlation. So if you look at when I touch at minus 12 degrees, there might be 7 spikes, there might be 6 spikes, there might be 5 spikes, there might be 4 spikes. If I touch at minus 6 degrees, there might be a few more spikes, or maybe a few less. There's this huge spread in spike count. Spike count is correlated, but really a crappy correlation with where you're being touched. And in fact, 6-7 spikes could happen when you're touched 12 degrees to the right or when you're touched 12 degrees to the left. And so as a computer, if all I tell you is there were 7 spikes, you'll be like, I don't know where you'd be, probably over to the right, but it's sort of a mess in a very broad a broad distribution. Whereas if you tell the computer the latency, there is still a spread, but it's a much tighter spread. And so if I tell the computer, for example, the latency is 40 milliseconds, then it can be for sure confident that I didn't touch it over here at the right side. Probably not even in the middle. There's only one up there. Maybe 6 degrees over to the left, but even that's unlikely with a 40 millisecond latency. Most likely, with a 40 millisecond latency, a computer can be much more confident that it was touched 12 degrees off to the left. And if you look at the latency, the difference between latency of PVL versus PVR, there's again a tight correlation with latency and sort of poor correlation with spike count. And so if you want your computer to get the answer right, then your best bet is to give it latency. Okay, so one more thing. I just want to kind of briefly introduce. So we'll come back to this on Monday. But this is our encoding experiment where we let the animal do the encoding and then we have our computer classify the stimulus. In the other experiment, what we do is we don't even touch the animal, and instead we drive spikes. We stimulate electrically PVL and PVR with precise timings and precise numbers of spikes. And we can then observe where the animal moves and see whether it's taking advantage of differences in rate or differences in timing. But we'll get back to that on Monday. So there's about 4 minutes left in class time. And what I want to do with that 4 minutes is have everybody, now you're going to write something down, briefly recap this, and then write down a question about anything at all in the unit. It can be from this lecture or anything earlier about information theory or Bayes' theorem or whatever. What do you want me to talk about, send you an email about, and hopefully talk about Monday night at the review session?